We have many, many questions. We'll just take a few, but so many of them were on this topic. Is Hugo Chavez really so dangerous? Is he and his government a threat to democracy and or capitalism in Latin America?
Look, I have a good experience on Venezuela, and I'm going to tell why. When the big confrontation between the opposition of Venezuela and the government of President Chavez appeared, and that was in 2002, 2003, I took this decision of going to Venezuela and work with the Carter Center under my leadership. And I stayed in Venezuela for almost 6 months. Went to Venezuela every week for 6 months. And I stayed there 3 or 4 years and sit in a table, the opposition and the government, to try to negotiate political solutions, to try to avoid violence. The violence that is appearing in Bolivia never happened in Venezuela. And to try to find a political solution to the big confrontation, the big crisis. This was after the coup, when President Chavez came back to government. And I learned a lot of things about Venezuela and how the political system was brought totally down because there was not enough political change in Venezuela. Countries need political change, which you cannot offer people a better standard of living. Democracies need to deliver on political change. And the governments of Carlos Andrés, the second government of Carlos Andrés Pérez and the second government of Caldera were not good at all in that matter. Created that idea of everything was paralyzed, nothing happened in that country, not politically, not economically, and the political system totally came down. The people got the idea that the problem of Venezuela was corruption. That probably was a totally wrong idea, but they got that idea in mind. President Chavez won the referendum revocatorio. That was the political solution we found. Many people don't like it because Chavez won, but he won. And it was a political solution. People voted, and he won 60 to 40, and that was the solution. Now, the possibility of Chavez bringing all the political change in a constitutional assembly brought the idea that with all the mistakes the opposition made, and the opposition made a lot of mistakes, and I can tell you why they made those mistakes, the democracy started to weaken in Venezuela, not because of the language of President Chavez that we all disapprove. He uses such a rough language and offensive, but because he got the majority in the assembly, he got the way to control the judiciary. And democracy is not only having the majority of people. He still maybe has the majority of people, but he doesn't have check and balances. He can do many things that in other democracy cannot be done because there are check and balances. That one power controls the other. That Congress controls the president. The Supreme Court controls the government and the Congress. That is the basic idea of democracy, the democracy as we want. And in Venezuela, we don't have that. It's not that Chavez is socialist. It's not that Chavez takes wrong decisions. The problem is he doesn't have enough checks and he's not accountable enough. And that is the problem of Venezuela. We cannot disapprove Chavez because he's socialist. I don't agree with that idea. I disagree with that is because he is not accountable because he has not enough checks and democracy is weak. He's making many wrong decisions economically, and that country is going to pay for that, I have no doubt. No doubt at all. Even with the price of oil of today of $100, he's going to bring those problems because he has given away money to subsidize poor people in Boston and New York and London. I mean, not only the Caribbeans and Central Americans, but now the poor people of many cities all around the world, he's subsidizing just to win some political standing. That is a wrong. Those are wrong ideas, and he's going to pay that country is going to have big troubles because those mistakes. But the problem of Venezuela is not because Chavez is a socialist. The problem of Venezuela is because he is anti-capitalist. He has moved with those ideas. He is not Fidel. I mean, he's not going to nationalize everything. But he has made some things that are arbitrary. Although he has paid all the nationalizations he has paid. Europe has done that many times, nationalization of companies and industries. That is a way of doing things. We may disagree with that, but that is not arbitrary in itself. Those are wrong decisions, I think. But he has paid everything he has seized. But the real problem is the lack of check and balances in this country, and that is the problem of the democracy in Venezuela.
Has U.S. Economic assistance to Colombia made a difference, particularly with respect to drug control?
I have been working with President Cardoso of Brazil and President Zedillo of Mexico and a group of intellectuals and journalists. The Latin America have been several meetings, and we have the last one, the next one. We don't know if Mexico or Costa Rica, but have been working on this. And it's a very strange thing. Colombia is a key pillar, of the fight against drugs. Really, the policy of drugs all around the world, it's important in very few countries. And those countries are the U.S., Colombia, Mexico now, Peru and Bolivia a little bit, Great Britain and Spain, and that's it. It's not more. Other countries don't care so much about drugs and don't give the problem the standing, the importance. And the U.S. is very powerful because put so much resources, because it's the only country that put people really in jail because of the consumption of drugs. It's almost today the only country, I think Japan and someone else, I don't know. But it's the only country that does that. And one of the key components of the policy of the U.S. is controlling the source, the supply of drugs to the U.S. And Plan Colombia was an effort to check on that because Colombia became very important. Colombia is the hub of the processing and is also the main producer of cocaine, of coca leaves. And FARC, that is a guerrilla movement, became very powerful with that source and control areas. And the paramilitary groups are the same. That is not political. It's basically drug trafficking. Paramilitaries of Colombia are drug trafficking. Not any more than that. The government made a mistake recognizing that they had some political standing. That was a big mistake. They are just drug lords. They are not any more than that. Now, when we see the efforts of Plan Colombia, what we see is Colombia has done everything. A professor of Miami University, Bruce Bagley, has said something very intelligent. Colombia did everything that was asked the patient. I mean, everything. And FARC has been defeated militarily and has been a big effort of eradication of coca plantations. But at the end, when you see the results, and I think Washington is starting to be aware of that, the supply of drugs to the U.S. is not diminishing at all. Not even the plantations. Colombian plantations of coca leaves are now all over the country, in a lot more. Colombians have learned to get more productivity out of the plants. They are putting more plants on place. They are putting in the coca leaves some substances, so the spraying, because Colombia is the only country that sprays the camps to destroy the coca plantations. They're doing everything. And now when you see the supply, the government of Colombia had a big fight with United Nations, with the United Nations agency, because they say that the area from last year, from 2006 to 2007, grew 20,000 hectares or something, from 70-something to 90-something.